regarding what's out there and how it all works. I'll do a brief overview and then tell you a little bit of what I do with OSINT Combine. I'll just jump into the first slide and give you some of the background on me. I grew up on a sheep farm. And being on that sheep farm, my dad said, hey, computers are very important. I don't know why he thought that, but he threw me into it from a young age. And fast forward, I get to uni, the University of Southern California, and that's when a lot of the current technologies regarding social media and collection of data really come into being. Two big things happen. One, Facebook. Facebook was not the first social media site, but it's currently the most widely used. And two, smartphones. After that, I did politics for a little bit, then I came down and started to study law in the U.S., got a scholarship down in Monash, studied law in Monash, ended up with two law degrees, went back to the U.S., practiced law, and started my company with my mates called Morning Consult. Morning Consult is what started off being a company that collected data through surveys, online market research through surveys. And at the time, not many people were using this. It wasn't looked on too positively, but we actually came up with the hidden Trump data. The company exploded because we were the ones who had data to show that Trump was likely to win the nomination, and he did. So overnight, the entire technology regarding online market research blew up. But online market research is just surveys, but in a digital world, allowing you to do video and collect further data on you, including where you're located. We've started bringing Twitter data as well, because Twitter data, people wanted that sentiment. We also looked at bringing in Facebook data, what turned out to be Cambridge Analytica. We didn't take it in because it was too expensive. Thank goodness for us. Several years later, my partner wanted to move it down here. I moved down here. I worked for LawPath, which is a legal technology company focused on startups up in Sydney. And then I recently went in and started work with OSINT Combine. OSINT Combine is an open source intelligence company. I'll get into a little bit more detail, but it takes in a lot of that data and allows people to synthesize it. Now, just before we get started, what are some of the types of data that come to mind when we're talking about data? Anything?
Location.
Location.
Credit card details.
Credit card details.
Consumer habits.
Location.
All these things. Identity. All these things. I've broken it down to a few different topics. People can disagree with me, but health, demographic, communications, actions, consumption belief, and trade and IP. Well, let's break these down. Health, everybody knows what health is. But how are we collecting it? Health is you go to the doctor, right? Yeah, they do records, traditional paper, then they now it's become digital. But what about how many people in here have smart watches on their wrists? About half the people in here. Every time you take a step, that's health data. Every time your heart beats, that's health data. And we're producing it and we're providing it. We sync this up with our phones. The phone has turned everybody into a sensor. How many different types of sensors are in here? We have voice, we have location, we have altimeters in here, and how many apps do we all have on our smartphones? I can't even tell you how many there are on mine, and I try to delete as many, and I just keep adding more and more. Do we even read what's on there? No. We're giving up our data, it's being traded out there, and to be honest with you, it's always listening. It's always listening. Now, the sources of data are just increasing as everything becomes more connected. We can think about computers and phones. I threw in their fridges and cars, but what other smart devices do we have?
TVs.
Well, what has Justin just bought that he was telling me have cameras? Artificial intelligence incorporated into it to track people? Refrigerators. We have refrigerators that are going to be smart, and they're being sold as you don't even need to tell anybody that you need milk. It'll automatically go out and report that you need more milk. We have Alexas in our house. We have smart Nest thermostats. Everything's connected to a single router to the internet. What about all of our smart meters? I think in Australia, every house now has a smart meter. That is all data being collected. And that's what is the purpose of this data? What are some, what some people can be using it for? How many people in this room use that? What are some of the uses that you use it for?
Students, definitely.
We use it for guest location data, so we know where they're coming from, so we know what to target.
Target?
Yeah. Forecasting.
Forecasting. Forecasting your business. Forecasting how much money you're going to be having coming in. Forecasting when you're going to need new supplies.
Voter intent.
Yes.
What was that one?
Voter intent.
Sentiments.
Sentiments. Sentiments. Yes.
You can charge more for sentiment.
That's right.
But if we go back to demographic data, think about what that demographic means. It's our height. It's everything that's on our license. But it's also how long our parents have lived, how long we're likely to live. We love to do the DNA tests and send it out and find out where we're actually located, where we're from. There are so many new sets of data out there that it's difficult to really even comprehend what it is. But at the end of the day, I put up this Excel sheet because that's what it comes down to. It comes down to a person, a name. You can put the data in, you don't truly need the date, a location, and some type of attribute. And your Excel sheet, every one of our Excel sheets, larger than I can even fathom. A company 10 years ago claimed that they had 30,000 records on every adult in the U.S. 30,000? I can't think of that many categories about me. But they're out there, and they're being used, not just for bad things. They're being used. Advertisers. It's become more efficient. It's become more efficient being able to target who you want to target to get your message out there. That's what the business community here cares about, is finding clients to go and target. You find them across the internet, but it's not just across the internet. You have smart billboards in Melbourne that are targeting in on consumers that are passing by based off of information on their phone. We leave our Bluetooths on, we leave our Wi-Fis on, and the telecommunication companies are always collecting data on us, as long as our phone is on. So this right here, chuck it out the window, put it out the window.
Turn it off first.
But it also is collecting public sentiment. And I did put that in there because there's so much, the way that I got into the data business was we were running polls for largely lobbying firms and politicians. And public sentiment matters so much. It can change what businesses think, what they do, changes what politicians do. There was recently, just a couple days ago, that showed that FCC, back in the US, the Federal Communications Commission, had opened up requests for information from the public regarding changing some regulations. Millions of fake submissions were provided on both sides. It wasn't one side or the other. People had taken data from the dark web, from data breaches, from real interactions with them, created profiles, and put in submissions. So it does have an effect. And then the regulators get this, they look at it, they think that people are very interested in the topic, and it can actually create change that affects us all, and we don't even realize it, based off of data that we have out there. Insurance, I have an insurance company that wanted me to put a transponder on my car, promised me lower prices if I put that transponder on my car to track me. But I didn't use it because my fear was, what happens if I get in an accident? They say, well, you're driving erratically. We're not covering you anymore. Insurance companies are largely in the business of not saving their own money. But it's also created automation, efficiencies. With this data, we can have smart health. We can have people that are doing surgeries across the world and creating new innovative techniques. Efficiency. How many people have Google phones on here that you have 20 devices and they're all connected in, and you get up and you leave the house after looking at something on your computer and you have it on your phone as you're driving, and you just press one button and it's great because you don't even have to think too hard about where you're heading. It's provided to you. Government, law enforcement, national security, we're able to track bad actors before they're able to go after and attack. It's creating smarter cities. Take all that data and we say, you know what, we don't need that road there. Or it speeds up those traffic lights. Hey, I don't have to sit in a red light as much anymore. And it really assists in innovation. what are the laws that are protecting us? And I put a few up here. I'll tell you, there's not many. The Privacy Act in Australia doesn't do much. It's going to be reformed soon. Privacy Common Law doesn't really exist. The Surveillance Act is state-based mostly, so depending on the state, you can't really track private communications. And consumer law. As long as consumers, or as long as companies are telling you the truth, that generally will protect, you won't fall under that one. So there's not much actually controlling how data is used in Australia and globally. But I want to talk about some of the dangers of data. How many people here have received phishing emails, texts, WhatsApps? Anybody get one recently? Every day, and especially for businesses. Hacking, phishing, scams, social engineering. I want to talk a little bit about social engineering. What is this? Because it kind of encompasses everything. Social engineering is taking that, all that data that's out there, and then learning. People, bad actors, will actually sit there and learn about you, learn about your business. After they figured out a way to get in, or they've targeted you based off of using similar email addresses to things they find on the internet, they'll send you a phishing email scam. They'll get into your network, they'll sit there, they'll find out how your payroll works or how your monthly payments to your vendors are, and they'll send an email saying, oh, don't send, I just got a message from Tom. Tom said, don't pay through this account, pay through this account, and the money's sent off two different accounts overseas, and the money's never seen again. So it's not just about getting in, it's about taking all that data that's out there and using it to their own benefit. I'll give you an example. Other than phishing and all these others, you may have heard that Microsoft's been recently hacked. And it's an ongoing hack, it's massive. And they think that there's a Wall Street Journal article that said that it likely occurred because the information that we all put out there as business owners, when we're trying to hire somebody, we're putting information about our company out there. Come in, we're using these types of computers, these are the benefits we're providing. And we put so much information trying to get new employees to come in. Same thing happens with the massive computer companies. These are all the different systems we're using. And then they incorporated it with breach data, stuff that they found from hacks about people's email addresses, and simply changed a little bit about the domain name to make it look like it was real, and they were able to get into the entire computer systems and were there for ages. Now, there's also surveillance, social credit scores. I don't know if anybody's heard about that. Anybody heard about social credit scores? China? China's created a system taking all this information. They don't have very many options for what type of apps they're using. WeChat, QQ, two of the main ones. So they have all that data in a single source. And then they're able to track. It's very dystopian. They're able to track their citizens. And if they don't toe the government line, they suddenly won't be able to go out and get a train ticket, a plane ticket. They won't be able to use their phones to get a delivery in 5 days because they're not towing the government line or they're making missteps on whoever's tracking them. So these are real, today, things that all this data is being used for. And I want to believe it could never happen here, it could never happen in Western democracies, but I don't. there's also the spread of disinformation. Very topical today. There's a lot of disinformation about people that don't 5G. Anybody hear about 5G towers getting burned down?
Spreading COVID.
Spreading COVID.
And the vaccine putting a chip in here. It's working nicely.
We've all heard these. We've all heard these, and these are just recent ones. Disinformation's been around for ages. If you look back, the U.S. went to war with Spain based off of disinformation about the Spaniards blowing up a ship down in Cuba. That was 100 years ago. So disinformation is not new, but the way that it spreads, how rapidly it spreads, how many articles are we reading a day on our phone? many things are sent to us by our mates. And there's so much information out there that there's a lot of noise. And getting through that noise is difficult. And I don't think our brains are yet developed to deal with all that information that we deal with on a daily basis that does make our lives better, but also bombards us nonstop. I just want to throw up here some recent hacks that have occurred just in Q1. There's a link down at the bottom that has a ton more just that happened in April, but these major ones that happened just in Q1 does affect us. I think that's a global company, Celeron, that you've never heard of, but they have ASIC. They have a connection to ASIC. Planes, Bombardier, computers, Acers, the Microsoft Exchange I was talking about. This is one of the scariest ones. Florida water system. All of our energy, all of our utilities are all connected to the internet today. Hackers can get in there and change how much fluoride or how much chlorine is in the water, and that has real world effects on large populations overnight. Luckily, nothing nefarious happened, or they stopped that one before it got too damaging. Channel 9. So let me tell you a little bit about OSINT Combine. And I'll get through this quick so everybody doesn't glaze over. OSINT Combine, open source intelligence. We bring in a lot of data. We provide training, services, and software, and mostly to the government, but also to high target companies. And the question is, what do we do with this data? An example I'll give you is a company that we recently were hired by to look into how much of this information is out there on their C-suite. We went to their CEO, we looked at their CEO. We found that the CEO was an avid bicyclist. He used the app Strava, was out bicycling nearly every day. And you upload exactly where you are. Connect with your phone. We knew exactly what circuit he was running nearly every day. We knew what times he went. I mean, we found out where his children go to school, like likely when his wife would be out taking those kids to school. So we knew when the house would be empty. We knew likely when the house would be empty, likely when he would be alone. And where, at any point, if he wanted to tap into that, the pain points in his family or within where his children are going to school. So any actor within that family you would have contact with if you wanted to. We also looked at information regarding some of the trolls that were trolling the company. We found out that the employees were the ones creating the websites to troll the company. Your people inside actors are some of the riskiest to you. It's not just outside actors, it's inside actors too. They had secret servers. We were able to find the location of the secret servers. We were able, using open, all this is open source, the location, what security methods they were using, and using different satellite imagery providers, showed the endpoints on the roof, front door, and side doors to their secret servers. And then we were also able to get a lot of the information about what they're using inside for software, and if there's any, and also a lot of the breach data. It'd be a quick search to see what's out there in the breach data world. It has passwords, IP address, and then provides locations to where you've been logging in. You look at this photo right here. I'll just, going back to that everybody's a sensor, this is a real-time terrorist attack over in Europe. And what we do today, all of us, with our phone, take photos and send them to people in real time, quicker than any news can get there, police, or anything else. That's one benefit that government, law enforcement has, is that they're getting real time updates. Using, again, back to our phones or sensors, and every time that we are connecting with social media, we can, and it provides locations most of the time. You could just drop a geofence, just a circle around a map, and find out all the different devices that are in that area, sending information in real time. And that is the photo that's on the left of all those different social media sites. Probably so, Twitters, Facebooks, BK, ones you've never heard of that are providing their real-time geolocation and information to the public. So what we do is find vulnerability. You have to think about your IT systems, the people. The people are, we are not a cybersecurity company. We are an intelligence company that's marrying all the information out there, making it easier for analysts to actually ingest and fight through all that noise and all that chatter, because there's so much data out there, and make real-time decisions. What can we do? Stay vigilant, stay aware, and stay educated. And I'll just go to the last slide. That's more information about us, but Project Lab, which is a cybersecurity company here in Tasmania, who's been in contact with Ian, has a new program, CyberUp, and they're providing information about cybersecurity and also discounted training or services. So if you have any questions about cyber, that's my pitch for them, I promise I do.
Yeah, that's good. Thanks very much. Any questions?
Yes. the bit that you were saying about us always listening in, let's have some old people, Mr. Rumi, up and say, so they're listening in. I say, no, of course they're not. Could you please just go through that a little bit more? Who is they, and how does that work? Is it recorded somewhere? I mean, does it have to be connected to Siri? What?
No, I'll give you an example. Amazon. Let me see if I saved this one. A note on this. So Alexa was recording. So any kind of device that you can just say, "Hey Siri, hey Alexa," it has to be listening.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if it has that capability, if you're not turning off all the microphone features, then there's permissions within all the apps. If you're not turning those off,
yes, all those apps are listening. But who is listening besides?
It can be computers are listening. For Alexa, they actually had people listening to train. So they actually had staff members listening to all the recordings on those Alexas, coming in through those Alexas. They promise they're not doing it anymore. All right, I'll leave that to you.
So all the apps that you have in the background that you haven't turned the microphone feature off, they're listening and recording.
They can be. They can be.
They might be listening for keywords. You know, if you say, "Oh, yeah, I think I might go and buy an accordion," yeah. And then 2 days later, all of a sudden, you get ads for accordions popping up in your feed.
On 2 days, that afternoon.
Or immediately. But that can be helpful, too. Do you really want ads that aren't catered to you? So there's benefits to it, too. That's what I want to remind. There's a lot of benefits to all this data, too.
That's not against the privacy laws at the moment, though, or what?
We can have a long chat about the privacy laws. But,
the assumption is you've consented in a way. I mean,
that's the way through.
You haven't opted out.
But they have to take it down, you said, right? You just said Amazon had to.
Well, because they're embarrassed.
People listening. Yeah.
So with the latest update that creates, says that you have to consent to your data being shared, so every time you open a new app, it pops up and I say no, will that actually do anything? I'm very skeptical.
I think it will. I think that most people in the industry do follow what the public sentiment is. And through the consumer law, if they're lying, then the regulators can go after them, and you can go after them. But at the same time, recently, a couple, I think it was Huawei back in China, said that they're just going to circumvent it. So it's not the end all be all.
Adam. It sounds like trend-wise, when the internet popped up, everybody was like, push it all online, publicity, want to be out there. Have we seen an inflection point where people are seeking privacy as a trend more?
I would say it's much more in the discussion. If you look globally at privacy laws, GDPR came into the works, I think, 2018 in Europe. And that was the pretty much the big player, and still is the big player on the block for privacy laws. But since then, you've had Brazil come out with their privacy laws. There's discussions of updating the privacy laws here. The U.S., on a state-by-state basis, they're passing new privacy laws. India, China, you name it, South Africa, New Zealand just updated their privacy laws, and you guys are doing business over there just at the end of the last year. They have new privacy laws and new requirements for sharing information internationally. So yes, I think that there is a more of a topic that's being discussed, but in the real world, we're producing more data every day, and how we deal with that is we all need to deal with it. So no single player can tell us, protect us. It's something that we need to be aware of and take active steps to reduce how much data we have, protect the data, and keep informed, because we're all getting phished.
Because you talk about the need for that CEO to be more private. Don't put your map of where you are at every moment. And Leone's constituents are concerned about their privacy. So not at the legal level, because that takes a long time to get there, right? But at the current personal level, like, I'm more concerned about my privacy, especially after hearing that. Do you see that? Do you sense that in the marketplace as a trend that's growing or shrinking?
Oh, I think it's definitely growing, but growing discussions and awareness is the first step. Action. I'm not certain that there's a growing action.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's great. That's helpful.
The COVID checking app, and even giving you details, people are saying, "No, look, I don't want to leave my details." I'm sorry, your details are already everywhere. But one of the things I want to raise is that we've seen, and those who might have watched SBS last weekend with Jess Hill's story and read the book about the use of tracking devices for perpetrators of family violence. This is becoming a real problem, and this makes it so easy. Mostly, and not to even be aware. So, this is a really serious problem, an absolute serious threat to so many women in our society. We've still got one woman a year being murdered, one woman a week being murdered, and so by reaching a hard form of violence. So, how do we better prepare victims of coercive control to recognise what's happening?
I think it's a lot about education. It is about education, about what you're leaving out there, your digital footprint. A lot of people I've talked with, and I say, hey, you should take privacy seriously. They're like, oh, I have nothing to hide.
Yeah.
But it's not about having nothing to hide. It's about social engineering. How easy is it to get in and hack somebody's bank account, or just have somebody transfer money somewhere else, or steal your intellectual property, trick somebody into sending some secret motors designs overseas to maybe a threat actor. There's so much data out there that we should be concerned about, leaving how our digital footprint is. And people will follow your Facebook and your other social media that's public, and they'll go and larceny your houses. They'll go in and rob your house because they know you're not there. That's happened. It happens all the time. And we only hear about it when somebody famous gets robbed back in Hollywood or something, because they posted that they're in the UAE on a flight. Oh, might as well just walk in. But it's everybody, and especially people who are actually under threat, such as the women of family violence that you're talking about, to not only have them be aware, but other people be aware that posting this information about you, where you are, your family members, everybody's interconnected, that you need to be aware of your footprint. And I don't think education is the only way that we can move forward.
We need services where they can take their phone and check if there's been something put on it. Because that's what's happening. Like, you know, if you watch that program, instead of scanning vehicles for tracking devices, you saw them getting into the computers and the phones of the women to see if they've been secret spyware basically put on there to enable them to be tracked by the perpetrator.
So a lot of the spyware and a lot of the ransomware has been commoditized. You can go into the dark web and buy it for very cheap. And that's, I believe that's what's happening with the oil pipeline back in the U.S. right now. You had some people that went in there, bought some ransomware online, threw it on, and they said they didn't mean to shut down the entire system. But they did, because they didn't know really how to use it, because they just bought it. And you can buy these different softwares on the dark web. The dark web is not a very difficult place to get to. You know, you hear the dark web, how do you get there? You can download a Tor browser and then you'll find forums, and they'll link you to something else, send you a link to go somewhere else that can then get shut down later on. And it's not super deep. It just takes a few steps to get there. And so you can find these spy apps across. It's not that difficult to find them, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think you're right about education. Parents I meet with, the kids have their phone and download software that they want to play with mom and dad's phone. They don't even want to.
Yeah. Rod, you had a question?
Just an example on the coast, this is true. The PA got an email, the phraseology was the same phraseology that the hospital used, and it said, this is the number, transfer $35,000 into XYZ account. And this lady's just like smart, she transferred the money. Now, the dumb thing is, he never asked her to do that before, so she should have questioned that. So that $35,000 went, so I got that. Then she got another request for another $50,000. Then she did that transaction too. Then the alarm bells rang. Got on the bank, managed to stop the $50,000, but they got the $35,000.
Wasn't that the efficiency?
I think, didn't Burnie Council get hit some years ago?
I think that might be right, but it's a scam and it's operating widely.
Can it be personal property?
It can be anything, but essentially it's that sort of false direction to change invoice, bank details on invoice. It happens all the time.
And people, people just posting on Facebook, they say, what was your first pet? And I go in and say, I had a dog called Rover. Okay. Well, I think that's not his real name.
Live script. Live script just sending all your information out there.
Where did you grow up? What was the first street you lived in? So you say Smith Street. So they're typical challenge questions when you try and change your password.
Yeah.
So I've just given someone Rover's name and Smith Street. So they've just got to find out one or two other things and they can get it. They just store that away. And hundreds of people pile on and say, mine was Billion, mine was Spot and all of that. And they're just handing the data out there.
They can go to your LinkedIn website page and get the rest of the information from you.
Exactly. Yeah. So anyway, we have to wrap up now. We've gone over time. Thank you very
Sorry,
much.
Sorry, guys.
It's great. I think it was a great break. Everyone, we'll see you in a couple of weeks. Don't forget to look for the Friedenberg lunch next month.
Friedenberg, we'll see you.